How you feel about the Honorable Louis Farrakhan coming to Atlanta?
I am very, very happy the Honorable Louis Farrakhan is here. I think it is a great, great day. It's a great day. And I am so happy to see all the brothers out and all the sisters out supporting the brothers. And I love the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. He is a wonderful, wonderful person.
And you, sister, how you feel?
I feel good, real good. He needs to come out often. And the brothers need to come out and support the nation, and Brother Farrakhan, Louis Farrakhan, need to come out and support, help build the nation, because we need all black young brothers, all of them.
Well, I feel there's a need for a message to the people, and I feel that he has a valuable message for us, and that's why I came down today.
I think it's good, his purpose. I think the purpose is good. Anytime there's something that brings black men together, that teaches them, enhances their knowledge, I think it's fabulous.
It is the greatest thing to happen in 6,000 years to Atlanta. For other than the Honorable Elijah Muhammad coming from Sandersville, Mr. Farrakhan here tonight is probably one of the greatest things that ever happened in Atlanta in 6,000 years, since Atlanta was ever connected to wherever it was connected to before it got disconnected.
I'm very excited that Minister Farrakhan has chosen to come to speak to the black men in Atlanta. I think it's really exciting. It makes me feel good when a brother is interested enough to come speak to the black men, you know, of America and travel around, you know, to America and speak to us about, you know, the problems that are facing us.
I think it's an excellent experience for the Southern people who are down here, because everyone needs an awakening of the mind. So in this case, it's a blessing, trust me.
Well, with the plight of black men right now, I think it's imperative that Minister Farrakhan speak as often as possible. I think we all need to be able to hear what the truth is. I think it's time for us to stop hearing a lie and believe the truth.
I'm all for it. I go to Graham State University, and I went to see him down there, so I want to come up here and get the further knowledge that he's here to bring.
I think it's great, and I think that he could really get to all the black brothers here, because they need it. And we need to be behind the black brothers to help them raise a nation.
I think that it's very good that Minister Farrakhan is coming here to Atlanta, Georgia, because the brothers need to know that we want strong black men, and the person that can do it is the Honorable Louis Farrakhan Muhammad.
I'm glad he's here today, because we need a lot of brothers to come out and support him. I mean, he's a deep brother, and he's a good man. So we need some more brothers to come out and support him. He has a message for all the black men and the sisters. So I'm here to support the black men on today. So he's a good man.
How do you feel about the Honorable Louis Farrakhan coming to Atlanta?
Well, I really feel great and everything. I feel that it'd be inspiration, I always did want to get an opportunity to come down here to hear him talk. And I bet I can get a good message out of the whole sermon.
Are you ready to hear from the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan? Come on, Atlanta. You know, the Honorable Marcus Mosiah Garvey says, one people and one destiny. In order for us to have one destiny, we must have one man that have the ability to crystallize us into oneness. And this is what we have today. A black man that you and I respect and love. You know, Farrakhan won't sell you out. Farrakhan have the solution, and that's why he come to Atlanta, Georgia, to deliver the historic message, let us make man. Are you ready to hear from the Honorable Louis Farrakhan? Praise belongs to Allah. One more time, and we'll have him out. Here he is. Here he is, the Honorable Louis Minister Farrakhan. Thank you.
In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, the one God to whom all praise is due, the Lord of the worlds. Allah, the creator of all things, Allah, the sender of all prophets, Allah, the revealer of all truth. To him alone do I submit and seek refuge. We thank him for Moses and the Torah. We thank him for Jesus and the gospel. We thank him for Muhammad and the Quran. Peace be upon these worthy servants of God. As a student of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, I could never thank Allah enough for his intervention in our affairs, in the person of Master Farrakhan Muhammad, the great Mahdi. We thank him. We thank him for his coming, and we thank him for searching among us for one who was worthy to carry a message to the black man. He found that one in the person of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and made him his messenger to us and his messenger to the black peoples of the earth and ultimately to the whole human family. We thank him for our beloved leader, teacher, and guide, the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. I greet all of you, my dear brothers, with the greeting words of peace. Assalamu alaikum. To Minister Van Muhammad and all of the hard-working believers of Mosque Number 15, thank you so very much for your hard work to get our brothers out tonight. Words are inadequate to express our gratitude to each and every one who passed out a flyer or who told a brother, come on, brother, let's come and hear what Brother Farrakhan has to say. Our gratitude to the reverend clergy that are present tonight, to the ministers of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, past and present, to all of the dignitaries on the dais, to the members of the press, and to each and every one of you who are present tonight. We thank you for your presence. You are not here at the call of Louis Farrakhan, but you are here at the call of God, that we as men must come together and decide what our destiny will be. It is a great privilege and honor for me to be here tonight in Atlanta, Georgia. Our thanks to the police department for their security, for their escort of me from our hotel to this auditorium. We thank you. We thank you. This is a beautiful audience of approximately 16,000 persons. I believe this auditorium holds about 19,000 for the games, with the floor, 19. Oh, it's about 16,000, 15,000, not bad. That's not bad. That's not bad. Thank you. We thank you. But I believe that probably this is the first time we have seen all of these men together in a room, just us, to talk about the things that concern us as men, our role in society, and what Allah, God, has for us to do. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad taught us, and the Holy Quran bears witness, that Allah has created nothing without an aim and a purpose. Everything that God creates has an aim, has a purpose. Well, then what is the purpose for man? Since God is the creator, and there is no creator other than He, then what is His purpose for you, for me? Are we to walk the streets of Atlanta aimless? Are we just here to gamble and sport and play our lives away? Are we here just to make babies through the sex drive and leave them alone in the world with no guidance? What is our purpose for being? The Bible constantly uses the soft pronoun us. And the Quran uses the soft pronoun we. Allah says over and over again, and we adorned the lower heavens with stars. We did it. And Allah said, and we created the heavens and the earth with truth. And Allah said, and we raised the mountains in the earth, lest it convulse and carry you away. And we created man. And we know what his mind suggests to him. Who is this we, since Allah is alone and singular, has no equal, is incomparable and matchless, and has no associate? Well, wait a minute. If God has no partners and no associates, why say we? Who is the we here? Since God created sun, moon, star, gives it aim and purpose, creates trees and birds and bees and plants and fish and insects and ants, even down to the smallest creature, the flea. Then go beyond that to the atom. Then go beyond that to the electron, to the proton, to the quarks. There is nothing that he created without a purpose. Allah says in the Quran that he created man in the best of modes. He has made man superior to everything in the universe. What? Wait a minute, Farrakhan. Now, aren't you stretching this a little bit? No. He created man greater than the sun, greater than the moon and the stars, greater than any creature in creation. Man is above them all, for he has created everything to serve man and created man to serve him and him alone. Now let's look at this. The cattle is our servant.
Yeah, go ahead. That's right.
All the lower animals are our servants.
Go ahead.
We put them under burdens. And they don't resist us. Man can train the lower creatures. But man also has the ability to master the forces and laws that govern nature itself. Yes. Man has powers that man has not yet discovered. True man, we have not seen yet. What you're looking at for man is a reasonable facsimile, but you have not seen man in his glorified state, because what you're looking at now is fallen man. Man that has fallen away from the glory of God that God created man to reflect. Says the heavens and the earth glorify God. Everything glorifies God. But man is not a glory, but man is the. Let's look at the word the. Man is the glory of God. Now, the sun is wonderful, but it can't think.
Listen up.
The sun is magnificent, but it can't will. The sun is magnificent, but it can't change its course.
Teach on.
The moon is magnificent, but it can't think. You, male, female, you are the greatest of God's creation. If you and I were in our right state, we could say we determine such. And it is. Because only God can say kun fayakun, be. And it is, but he gives man and woman that right to dream or to vision, and then to bring into reality what we vision. No creature can do this but God and man. Allah says in the Quran that his throne is on water.
Go ahead.
What does that mean? The throne is that which bears up him who sits on it. The throne represents the seat of authority. God's throne is on water, meaning you don't even know he's king, he's ruler, he's sovereign, until you see what he has brought out of water.
Go ahead.
All living things, the Quran says, come from water. What is the brain composed of? Come on, talk to me. The brain is water, my friend. And this is the throne of God. And when God settles himself on the throne, meaning when you allow Allah to come into your life and submit your will to do the will of God, then the water of your brain cells becomes his throne, where from that seat of authority he can say through you and me, be, and it is. Man is a wonderful creature.
Bible.
Go ahead.
The Quran and the Bible says God created man, then woman. Both the Bible and the Quran are not sexist books.
Right. Yes, sir.
They're telling us something. God makes man, then woman, to complement man. But he made man for a purpose, and he made woman for a purpose. And when we do not fulfill our purpose, then we have not justified our existence in his universe.
Go ahead.
That means that an ant is better in the sight of God than a man who fails to fulfill his purpose. So the ant has a greater chance of surviving this time period than man. For man has become the dunghill of the earth, not worthy of life, because we have not yet fulfilled our purpose for existence. What you doing?
I ain't doing nothing.
Stop right there.
Wait a minute. Go ahead, Mr. Hill. Oh, go ahead.
Anytime you say, I ain't doing nothing, well, that's the end of that. Because God didn't create man to do nothing. He created man to do something. Well, what something? I play basketball. Now that is wonderful. That is wonderful. That is great. How long have you been at it?
Oh, since I was a youngster. I've been throwing balls in a hoop until I can perfect it now.
And they've trained dogs, and the dog with his nose put it right up in the hoop and hardly misses. So look at you. Look at us. We marvel at the majesty of a brother who can slam dunk in a most spectacular way. And you say, what a man. But God says, what? A man? What? You marvel at somebody who can knock another brother down. Right? It's magnificent. The skill is there. It's really beautiful mathematics. And you say, what? A man. And God says, what? A man? Another brother plays a horn, another brother dances, another brother sings, another brother plays, and you say, oh, they're magnificent. What a man. And God says, what? A man? I don't read anything in the book that says, I created man to sing and dance. I created man to play. The God who created the universe is a serious God. And the God who created man gave man a serious purpose. You have been the plaything of the world. Play for me, nigga. Sing for me, nigga. Dance for me, nigga. Dunk for me, nigga. Fight for me, nigga. Run for me, nigga. And of course, the better you are at those things that make the world pleased with you, television gives you a good image, the newspaper writers write about you, what a man. And God continues to say, what? A man?
Yes.
Go ahead. Not man. The Bible, Reverend, says, and God said, let us make man in our image and after our likeness. What did you say, God? I'm gonna make man in my image and after my likeness. What are you gonna do for him, God? I'm gonna put in his nature the power to rule. And I'm gonna give him power and dominion. A man is not a man without power and the ability to rule. If nobody else, he must know how to rule himself. And he gives man orders. In the word Genesis is the word gene. In the word gene, when you break it down, there is a genetic coding for each human being. And in that genetic coding is the characteristics, the talents, the abilities, the gifts, the capacity of this human being, not just from his parents or her parents and grandparents, but this coding goes all the way back to the root of you, which is God himself. Y'all all right? In your genetic coding, God said, multiply, replenish the earth, subdue it. In your genes, a man is by nature genetically coded to be a producer. The word multiply means produce. Not just produce the continuation of the human species, but to become productive with your life. You are supposed to take the multiplier, which is yourself, and what God put out here as a universe of opportunity, and the multiplier times the multiplicand will give you a product. Any man that is not a producer has not justified himself as a man. This is why white America continues to look at us as boys. This is why white America continues to treat us like boys. Because in their world, they produce and you act on their productivity. Huh? Work for me, but I produced the means. Come work for me. Well, boy, go to work. So from 9 to 5, you bussing it. I'm not saying it's dishonorable. It's wonderful if you got a job. But, you know, when I was coming up, they say heaven, every day in heaven would be like Sunday. Because on Sunday, everybody go to church, worship God, and don't work. Well, the first part of that is about true. Second part of that is true, rather. First part, I don't say we're worshiping God, but we're certainly not going to work. So every day in the black community is almost like Sunday. You got a day off. Some of you can't remember when the last time you worked. And it's because they, white folk, have not prepared a job for us, then we have been robbed of a creative mind. Listen. To prepare jobs for ourselves. So, when a man is a producer, he has to think.
That's right.
And deep in the midnight hour,
that's right. Yeah, yeah.
He'll wake up with a thought on his mind. And in that thought, when it's fully developed, it becomes an idea. When a man has an idea, you see a light go on in his head that reflects itself in his skin, because his brain is alive and God's throne is now activated on water. Now he must take it out of his mind and concretize it by saying be and make it reality. Now, when a man does that, he fulfills his destiny to reflect God in this sphere where God gives man dominion. Oh, brothers. The Quran says it a little different from the Bible. The Quran does not say man is made in the image or the likeness of God. The Quran says it in a very mathematically sound equation. It says Allah created man. From black mud. Oh, wait, wait. This is not racism. This is not racism. In the Quran, it's talking about the creation of Adam. Adam is first man. Adam is the prototype. Or the archetype. And everything from Adam is of Adam. He says he created Adam from black mud. Well, if he created him from black mud, he couldn't have come out a white man. All right, talk to me. Come on. Let's agree.
This is not racism to the Caucasians in the audience. I'm not trying to promote black supremacy. Because Allah in the Quran sounds the death knell to any kind of superiority based on any type of characteristic that he and he alone give. I'll get to that in a minute. So that's not what my purpose is. He created Adam from black mud, and then he breathed into Adam of his inspiration. He gave him wisdom. And in the wisdom is the power of the throne on the water to create, to build civilization. He says to Adam, after he makes him, he gives him a name in Arabic. Khalifa. Yes. Khalifa. What is that? I don't speak Arabic, neither do I, tell you the truth. But I know a word or two. And I'm not showing off except my ignorance, because I can't go any further. So, like most of us who know a little, we take that little and run it. Make people think we have a lot. But according to the scholars who know the language, they say Khalifa means God's vicegerent. He who supplies or takes the place of one, he who succeeds one who dies. That's what the language said. The scholars have lied on the language. Well, I don't know the language, so you'd have to forgive me. He who supplies the place of another. Stop. If Adam is Khalifa, the vicegerent of God, then Adam was made to take the place of God. You cannot take the place of God unless you are endowed with similar characteristics or attributes that God has. I want you Muslims to listen. This is why killing human beings, destroying human beings, is a great crime with God. And this is why God gives man the right to wear his names. We say that Allah alone is worthy of praise. So we say, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Praise belongs wholly to God, the Lord of all the world. But yet, he allows man to wear the name Muhammad, which means one worthy of praise and one praised much. Allah is Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. He is the beneficent. He is
the merciful. But Khalifa cannot rule in the place of God unless he is a reflector of Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. He must be a reflection of God's mercy, God's beneficence, God's creativity, God's generosity, God's power, God's ability to judge, God's ability to destroy, God's ability to give life. It is all in man to reflect God. David, the psalmist, says, ye are all God's children of the Most High God. If you say we are children of God, do you know what you're saying? I'm the child of my father. I never knew him, but I would imagine I reflect something from him. If I'm of him. If man is a child of God, then every man is a potential son. Not that God has sons and daughters, but every man has the potential, as a son reflects a father, to reflect the magnificence of God. And this is why, we are called, using the definite article, the glory of God. You who think you are the least in this audience tonight, you have the magnificent ability, capacity, to reflect God, not in mediocrity, because there is no mediocrity in God. There are only degrees of excellence. Each one of us has the capacity to reflect the excellence of God. In this world, we reflect it on the lowest level of activity. We reflect his greatness in song. Don't seem like anybody can sing like us. I mean, they try. And sometimes they come so close, we think it's us. But since you are the man, the descendant of the original, the originator, the archetype, then everybody who has soul got it. From that first one who got it from God. And he made Adam from black mud. And he fashioned him into shape. He gave him wisdom superior to the angels. According to the Quran, he said to the angels, But to Adam, ask the angels their names. And the angels could not tell Adam their name. Then God instructed Adam, tell them their names. And Adam began to recite to the angels what they didn't know. Then God goes a little further. He said to the angels, make obeisance to Adam. I made a man, now I want the angels to bow down to the man that I made. Now angels don't bow to nothing or nobody but God. But God now makes a man and calls him Khalifa, and then tells the angels, don't worry about bowing to me, bow to him that I made. And all of them bowed except Iblis. This is the Quran. Iblis. Excuse me. Iblis is another name for the rebellious one. God says to Iblis, what hindered you that you did not bow down when I commanded you? Listen to the answer of Iblis. I didn't bow down because, what's your reason? I am better than he. For I am made of fire, while you made him from dust. I don't like his humble origin. So I ain't bowing to him, even though you made him and asked me to bow. And Allah said to Iblis, get out of it. Driven away. So Iblis, failing to bow at the command of God, rebelled against God. Then God put him out of an exalted state and told him, get out of it, driven away. So then every Muslim, when he prays, he says, Qul a'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajeem. I seek refuge in Allah from the accursed devil. One accursed, one removed from, one driven away from the face of God. How do you become driven away from the face of God? When you rebel against direct orders from God. He made man. Talking about you, brother. You don't know who you are. Calling yourself Negro, colored, African American, West Indian, Nigerian, Jamaican, Trinidadian. These are very limited, cheap descriptions for you. My body is from the earth, but the earth cannot define me. I'm going to say that again.
Think about it. Teach it.
Wake us up. My body is from the earth, but the earth cannot define me.
Think about it.
Therefore, to use any land mass,
as a description of myself is inadequate, because that only describes the physical characteristics of someone who is far more dimensional than a one-dimensional creature from the earth. The earth can only fashion the house that I live in. And since at best it is not permanent, then this house must return. But the spirit that lives in this house lives beyond the house. Come on, let's look at it. Y'all all right? Oh man, you something, and black man, you something else. This may be a little deep, it's not emotional. But, dear brothers, if you can see the spiritual dimension of yourself, then when you look at the brother sitting next to you, that's an extension of God and an extension of yourself. So when you look at a fellow human being, that's who you're looking at. An extension of you and an extension of God. How then would you take a hatchet and cut off your foot except accidentally? That's part of you.
Right.
The brother sitting next to you, in back of you, around you, in the balcony. That's part of you. That's our natural family. That's the extension of God. So the Bible says, Reverend, how can you love God whom you have never seen and hate your brother whom you see every day? What is the root of that? The same unseen God has a reality in your brother. And when you disrespect your brother, you are disrespecting God. When you love your brother and do good by your brother, that is the same as doing an act of good for God. Oh, yes. I can prove it in any scripture you want to bring. The very nature of God is in man. That's why men do not like any pompous, arrogant jacktail over them. When you start strutting like you are more than they, something in them recoils and they withdraw their service from you as a leader. You are not their master. As a leader, you are their servant.
Allah says in the Quran, none comes to Allah except as an honored servant. So when you stand up over God's people and you are looked upon as some kind of leader, don't get carried away with yourself. I'm speaking to me as much as anybody else. Allah does not like that, because Allah knows He alone is worthy of worship. So don't you try to rob God of what rightfully belongs to Him when you claim to represent Him. Are you listening? Do you know why the leaders can't get your allegiance? Because they don't want to serve. They want to show you how great they are by showing you how little you are. So if you look at the leaders of men, they are arrogant jackasses. Arrogant. I don't mean that disrespectfully. A jackass is just a dumb thing. And anytime a man begins to think that he is greater than those whom he serves who are from God, he is one and they are many, then he's a jackass. And it's less than that, because the jackass knows his place. But the fool leader don't know his. And that's why, brothers, when we get in authority over our people, either voted in or chosen by some manner, we begin to arrogate to ourselves qualities that make us to feel I am better. And the moment you begin to think you are better than your brother, then you start the path of Iblis being driven away from the face of God, because you think, even in your subconscious mind, like the hypocritical Pharisees.
Go ahead.
When a man was praying, asking God to forgive his sins, and the Pharisee was thanking God that he didn't make him like that man. But you see, there's not one of us seated on this rostrum that is greater than any of you seated in the audience. No matter what we may have accomplished, we are only signs of greater accomplishment that lies dormant in you. So whenever we are exalted, our role is to serve God by serving man and getting man to recognize his great aim and purpose, that he may fulfill his destiny. Then God can say to you, Reverend, and to you, teacher, and to me, well done, thou good and faithful master. No, Well done, thou good and faithful servant. 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 White folk have not taught black men how to serve one another. And this is why, to white people, you are in trouble with God, because you have falsely been made to believe that you are better than other people simply because of the whiteness of your skin. Trying to make the darker people of the earth to feel themselves insignificant, unworthy, as though they never contributed anything to civilization. But you are the goose that laid the golden egg of civilization, and therefore all human beings must look up to, idolize, and worship you in the place of God. You have gone so crazy in your sick state of mind. That you, like Pharaoh, have made yourself a god beside God. So now man has become polytheistic. He says there's one God, but he worships many gods.
Listen up, listen up.
Some of my great Muslim brothers say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. I bear witness there is no God but Allah. And I bear witness that Muhammad is his messenger. There's a phone call for you. Who is it? It's President Clinton. Boeing is in trouble.
Go ahead.
We helped you out. Can you buy some planes?
Listen.
Well, I really don't need any. Can you buy some planes? Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah.
Go ahead.
Well, I really don't need any planes. Did you hear what I said? Boeing is in trouble. The French want us to buy Airbuses, but you will enrich the French economy, but we helped you. Will you buy the plane? Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. And then a week, yes, sir. And billions of dollars come out of the treasury to buy planes that we don't need, to shore up an economy that God's finger is against in the West. Don't call me a man that commits shirk and then call yourself a keeper of the holy house. Don't say that I am a man that sets up rivals with God. When you bow down to your low desires and make them a god beside God.
Go
Don't tell me I'm guilty of shirt. When you got a cigarette in your mouth, and even though it's killing your body, you can't put it down because you've become a slave to your appetite, yet you say five times a day, La ilaha illallah, you are a liar and a hypocrite. America has the whole world bowing down to the majesty of the power of America as though America is a god beside God. White people have supplanted the real image of Jesus Christ and made Jesus in their image, and then told us to worship Jesus as a God beside God. Reverend? 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 Jesus never taught one human being to worship Him. Jesus never taught one human being to worship Him. Jesus taught every human being that came under the power of His message to worship God and to worship God alone as He Himself was an example of the worship of God alone. Questioning Jesus. And Allah says to Jesus, did you tell them to take you and your mother for gods beside me? And Jesus answers saying, if I had, you would have known it, for you know what is in my mind, but I know not what is in yours. The Bible bears witness with the Quran. In the book of John, it is written, God is a spirit, and those that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. For such the Father seeketh. He didn't say, I'm seeking worshipers. He said, the Father is seeking. So when they said, Master, teach us how to pray. He didn't say, my Father, which art in heaven. He told them, say it like this. Our Father. Hold it right there, Jesus. What you mean, our Father? Didn't you have an immaculate birth? What you mean, our Father? Didn't God come down from heaven and get in to Mary? How could He be our father when my father laid down with my mother. And my mother gave birth to me from the sperm of a man. How could he be your father and my father? Well, Paul gives answers to this question in the book of Romans. Paul says Jesus was the seed of David according to the flesh. He was declared to be the Son of God according to the Spirit of holiness. Now let's reason with this. Look, David was a natural man who conceived or gave conception to children in a natural way. Since we have a body from the earth, and Jesus had a body from the earth, he had to have a father from the earth to father his earthly body. But Jesus was more than earth.
Go ahead,
minister.
Go ahead.
See, as a father, and I am a father of 9 children and 25 grandchildren and 1 great-grandchild, and all of these came the way they supposed to. However, there is a however. At a certain point in a child's life, when he is raised above the carnal or earthly desires and passions and lusts, and he comes into a consciousness that makes him recognize his connection to the divine, then he is birthed into that consciousness by the only one who can father that kind of consciousness. And that is God himself. Your father, no matter, and those of us who are preachers, we all want children to be servants of God. But no matter how much we desire it, Reverend, we can't produce it. You can read them the Bible and the Quran every day. I know Muslims that do that. I know Christians who do that. Here's my son. Now, son, let's get up and pray. Son, let's go to church. Son, come on now, because I want you to be a servant of God. By the time that boy gets up a little age, he said, look, pops, you know what I mean?
Go ahead.
I don't believe that stuff. Okay? I'm going on out and smoke me a joint. I'm going on out, bust me a cap on some dude down the street that been messing up. And after a while, father said, I don't know what happened to him.
That's what he said.
I did everything I could to make
Go
him
ahead,
right.
Go ahead,
I tried to train him right. I don't know why it turned out like this. But he could be the worst little fella as a young man. And at a certain point in his life, like Paul, or like Khalid bin Walid, or like those great men of God who in the beginning of their lives were persecutors of the righteous. Yes. Something happens in their life. And when that thing happens in their life, and they begin to recognize that divine connection to God, then like Jesus, they can say, Our Father.
Yes.
Because now they have risen above the earthly father. And now a heavenly father has acted in their life. Do you understand?
Yes.
Jesus is a sign of what is in you. I'm going to say it one more time. And Jesus is a sign of what is in you. And Muslims, we just celebrated what is called in Islam Eid al-Adha, the feast that celebrates the successful journey of the pilgrims to Mecca. But Muslims, Mecca and the Kaaba at Mecca are called signs.
Yeah. Minister.
And a sign is that which points to the real thing. That it is a sign of. That building in Mecca is a house of stone with a golden door and a little black, reddish, black stone in the corner. And as a Muslim, I have made Umrah and Hajj, making a circuit around that house 7 times.
Come on, go ahead, Minister, go ahead.
Go ahead.
I made a circuit around a sign. So if I walk around the sign, I am only performing that which is a sign. Uh-oh.
Go ahead.
That house is called Al-Bayt Allah, the house of Allah. Does Allah live there? No. When you open the door and go in the house, do you see Allah there? No, no, no. It is a sign of what? It is veiled over with a black veil called Kiswa. Why a black veil? Why then at a certain time is the veil open and you see a golden door?
Bring it.
And the Bible says, and the veil of the temple was rent.
Come on, Bill.
The veil is, you all right?
Yes.
The veil is that the real house of God will be covered, made obscure, hidden. And at the right time, the veil would be lifted and a door would be there to admit you into the house of God.
Jesus in the New Testament said, I am the door. Any man who enters in by me, the same shall be saved. And what this got to do with the black man, brother, and stopping to kill it?
See, if you understand that you're killing God, you think twice about popping a cap in your brother. When you understand who you are, then you will respect all men as you should. Oh, I could have made a little short subject that was fiery and fancy, and you'd have gone out of here fired up. But this that is in you tonight, it will last, brother. It's going to wake you up in the midnight hour. If you can sleep at all when I get finished with you today, and the next time you get an itch to kill your brother, to hurt your brother, to cheat your brother, to lie on your brother, to betray your brother, you're going to think twice, three times, four times. The next time you think about selling drugs to your brother, you're going to think twice, three times, four times. Because no amount of money is more valuable than that brother that is sitting next to you, in back of you, in front of you, all around you, in the city, in the projects. That is a child of God. Now follow me. Now, don't go nowhere, except go to the bathroom and come right back. Because this is serious. The real house of God is you. Wait. Now, we've been going to Mecca and making seven circuits around a house, and you won't even go next door to talk to your black brother. But you're going to go and kiss a stone and won't pucker up your lips to embrace your brother with a holy kiss, not the kiss of a homosexual.
Around the Kaaba means you got to walk around seven times, just like Joshua had to walk around the walls of Jericho. How many times? Seven times. What does it mean that for 6,000 years the house of God would be veiled because an unrighteous man will have been given dominion and power in the earth? So the real house of God had to be veiled in order that a false house may be set up. But in the 7,000 year after that Adam of this world, that veil of the temple would be rent. And a golden door would be there. A door that would admit us in again to the sanctum sanctorum, to the house of God. What does it mean? As I looked under the veil, I saw cinder blocks. Cinder blocks. Of course, there's been damage to that great house over time, but the significance remains the same. And when you go to Mecca, you get this magnificent feeling that you are in the august presence of God when you are in Mecca, and that is true. But if you get that when you're in the presence of the sign, what will you be like in the presence of that which it is a sign of? Now look, that building is stone. When you open the door, you go in, spirit, air, but you can't feel that somebody is in there. Well, what is it talking about? Look at this flesh. Brothers, the most magnificent mosque, synagogue, church, cathedral is the handiwork of man.
Oh, yes.
But this is the handiwork of the supreme architect of the universe. This is the house of God. But what's wrong? The Spirit of God is not in the house. I heard my brother when he was taking charity saying, so and so and so and so in the house.
Yes, sir.
Arsenio Hall said, so and so and so and so in the house. We knock on the door of that house. Who's in the house? It ain't God. Satan has replaced God in the house. I know Satan has replaced God in the house. Look at what we are doing with our hands. We are the number one beaters, rapers, robbers, murderers, and destroyers of our own people. Who's in the house? Satan in the house. Two things can't occupy the same space at the same time. So if Satan is in, God is out. Where's God? He's out to lunch. He's been out for 6,000 years. But when the Messiah comes, he represents the door that will allow God to come in again. And when God starts coming in, Satan starts going out, then God takes over the house, and the house becomes the house of God. You understand? How does God take over the house? See, you revolutionaries. I was talking to Muammar Gaddafi one day. And the good brother Gaddafi, he had just made a broadcast to our Savior's Day convention
via satellite. And he said, we've got 400,000 black men in the armed forces of America. He said, come on out of the army and I will arm you and you go and fight for your liberation. I said, well, Brother Gaddafi, I said, that's not going to work, sir. I said, I'm a revolutionary too. I said, but I'm not a revolutionary with a gun. But this Quran is destined to bring about a revolution in the world. This Quran overthrows governments. And the first government that the Quran overthrows is the false government of your mind. The revolution must take place in your head. And when you overthrow the government that's ruling now in your brain that got you acting like a fool, and replace that government with a righteous government of God, then you'll see your hands doing creative work,
right,
your feet walking in a righteous direction,
right,
your mind thinking on productive things for the good of yourself, your family, and your people. We need a revolution. And you need to overthrow the rider, the government of your head. Because in order to be a man, you must have manhood. A hood is that which covers the head. So you and I have a hood on, all right, but what's going on in the hood, under the hood? We're tearing up the hood, because there ain't nothing under the hood of righteousness. What's under the hood is a satanic mind produced by Satan himself. You're not following God. You are worshiping Satan in the name of God. You are just like the sons of God who came to present themselves before God, and Satan came with them. And they didn't even know that Satan was in their company. That's what's wrong with you. You hang out with Satan. You lie down with Satan. You get up with Satan. And you wonder why you are remote from God and remote from one another, accursed, driven away. Nobody wants you. Nobody loves you. Nobody cares about you. And because of our unproductive life, white folk are saying right now, they've become a great problem. And when this society says you've become a problem that they don't know how to solve, this is why they put erasers on pencils and erasers at the blackboard. They have decided to erase their problem. And that is why after all these years that we have worked for America. Our fathers built America. Our slave labor enriched America. Our blood has helped to defend America. But America has become our destroyer. America says, the niggers are multiplying. These black men don't know how to do anything productive except make babies. So they look at your birth rate and they're saying, my God, no matter what we do to them, they continue to multiply. And their demographers are saying by the year 2083, black people, if we continue to multiply at the rate that we are multiplying, and if whites continue at zero population growth, which means every time a child is born white, a white person dies at the same time, which means their population is not growing at the rate that our population is growing. Therefore, you have white folk getting older and older and older, while young black folk have a stronger and greater youth population that are fighting age and working age, but there's no jobs. And so your aggressive male tendencies must be used in a self-destructive way. So now in the hood, you've become gangs, not a brotherhood based on righteous principle, but you've degenerated into gangs. Gangs that got turf that you don't own. Your mother is renting a project house owned by the federal government, and you call it your turf. Why don't you make it yours?
Go ahead.
Then into that male spirit, which is an aggressive kind of spirit in a man. A man is by nature a soldier. But you gotta channel him, you gotta guide him, you gotta direct that aggressive tendency. So in the white community, they have playgrounds and ballparks and little leagues and police athletic leagues, something to channel the aggressive tendency in the male. But in the black community, there's nothing for our babies playing in alleys, playing in the streets, playing by the railroad tracks. Don't have any toys. They play with cards and stones and bricks and cans, and in their creative mind, taking a piece of board and cutting skates in half and making skateboards. This skateboard came from poor people.
Yes.
There's nothing to channel your energy. So the boys that live in this group, in this area of the town, don't like the boys that live in that area. So you better not cross over that street into this area. If you do, we're gonna deal on you. Can you imagine that white folk denied us all these years because of the color of our skin, and now we have become so dumb that we who wear blue are gonna kill somebody who's wearing red, or we who wear red is gonna kill somebody who wears blue because they don't have on the right color? You take your cap, and if you turn it backward, it mean one thing. If you turn it on the side, it mean another. If you turn it and cock it to the front, it mean another. And any one of the ways you cock your hat could get you killed. Look at you. The people of God killing each other over some Nike shoes. A Bulls jacket. Alligator shoes. Dope deals. So you carve up your community You sell drugs to your children, and you'll have money with a dead white president on a dollar. And you're dealing death to your people for a piece of paper that white folk have made valuable while they have devalued human life. And you, the people of God, have allowed them to devalue you and elevate the value of a car, a shoe, an alligator. Huh? You have devalued the spirit and life of God and made paper more valuable than human life. So you rob and you shoot and you kill for a paper with a dead cracker on the paper. Brothers, my brothers, look at what we have been made. You're the laughing stock of the world. You can join the army and be all that you can never be in society and go and fight on a foreign battlefield for a freedom that you have never enjoyed. Look at you, a devalued human being. And the house of God is veiled over with filth and indecency. The woman of God walks the streets of Atlanta a cheap prostitute, and the man of God makes her a whore, and he becomes a pimp, and this is the level of his productive life. He glories in sport and play while his mind refuses to revolve around creative ideas that would lift him into the realm that he may be a reflection of God. He is a devalued human being. And because your life is worth nothing, and you hate yourself as a black human being, then it's nothing to you to kill your brother. For what? A sour dope deal. The nigga took that powder, sold it, took that money, and didn't give me my cut. And you go and you pump bullets into him and watch him gasp his life away. And you don't realize, brothers, you are becoming the enemy of God. Because God's desire is to save the black man. And you are out there killing that which God wants to save. And to my Muslim brothers who are in the audience, who are Palestinians, who are our Arab brothers, you see my people in this condition, and you don't try to help them in their state of jahiliyyah. But yet God sent you a prophet in your state of ignorance to raise you with the Quran. But you have forgotten the book, and you put the book behind your back, and you set up your stores in our community, and you don't respect us. You see us in this condition, and you take advantage of our ignorance, and you take our women and you abuse them. You sell us pork, though God forbids you not just to eat it, but to touch its carcass. You sell us wine, beer, whiskey, and you laugh at us, and you mock us in our terrible condition. The Koreans come. They set up stores in our community, and we as men go and shop, and our wives go and give them our money, and they don't respect us because we have become a non-self-respecting people, and you can't get anybody to respect you if you won't respect yourself. You're dead, black man. You're God spirit, but is dead, and you need to be resurrected. You need to be enlivened. You need to be stood up. You need to be guided to the straight path of God. You need to have God knock on the door of your house. How does God knock on the door? He knocks on the door of the house by putting a word in your ears. Even as oxygen or inspiration comes in to the two nostrils, inspiration comes from the word of God that comes into the ears. And when they enter into the brain, they condemn the old ideas and drive the old ideas and the false concepts out. And then the throne of God begins to settle on the water. And then God can come now and settle himself on the throne. So that you got a new rider on the horse. Who's riding you, Farrakhan? Who's riding you, Farrakhan? Look at the horse and tell me who's riding me. Look at your brother. He got the whole damn world shook up. Look at your brother. Who's riding me? Can't you see? The veil is rent. God has come in to the house. And I let him in. He's taken over my brain. His throne is now settling in my head. This is why white people are afraid. There ain't never been a black man in the history of America that called black men together and they respond. Can't you see? It ain't no secret. Can tell you, Christian, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Why can't the world cause me to bow down? Why can't they frighten me away from my position? Why won't I sell out? Because I let him in the house. And he's taking over the house. God is in the house. And that's what makes the house valuable. It ain't what it looks like on the outside. It's who's on the inside. And every day that I say my prayers and feed my heart and mind on the word of God, Satan goes out and God comes in more and more. And I find myself can't wait to serve. To serve you. Because I know you are greater than I am. And if I can just serve you into the knowledge of yourself and your connection to God, that you can see that we are brothers, not from our mother's womb, but from the very essence of God Himself. He made you my brother, and He made me your brother. And when I look at you, I see God. And when you look at me, you should see God. Not that I am God. No. I'm a human being that's going to live and die. I'm not worthy of honor, praise, or worship. I'm a servant. But if I do my job right, then He will say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over little. Now I will make you ruler over much. Enter thou into thy joy. Brothers, we can end this madness overnight. Brothers, we can turn our communities around and turn the desert into an oasis and make it bloom where it never bloomed before. We got the power within us tonight to turn it around. All we got to do is open the ear and let Him in. He comes in on a word, and in the word is His will, and in His will is His idea, and in His idea and His will is His power. Let Him in. And when you let Him in and you take His word down into the heart until it overthrows the old government of Satan, and you don't anymore talk about I'm better because I'm black. You know you're black because you're the original. You know you're black because you are Khalifa. You are God's vicegerent on earth. You know that's your potential. Then let Him in. And let Him go in deep. And then let Him inspire faith. Any of you that walk with me, you walk with me by faith. 17 years ago when I started to rebuild the work of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, it was just one brother and myself. I had no money, but I had faith. I believed that the word of Elijah Muhammad not only was correct, is correct. Our understanding of that word was immature. But as we evolved in understanding that word was a key that would unlock the scriptures of the Bible and the Quran. And we would give an exegesis of Bible and Quran that no scholar of Bible and Quran ever thought was in the Bible and in the Quran. I cannot follow the scholars of Mecca. I cannot follow the scholars of Europe. They have messed up the world. I cannot let them lead me and guide me when they have gone off the path of God. Only the Mahdi can guide to the right path today.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
I cannot follow
Arabs, though I love them as my brother, and I thank God for the Arab nation. They are a good people and a great people, no matter how far they have sunk into degeneracy. That is a great people, because of all the people of the earth who ever received a revelation from God, the Arab kept the book pure. And for that, they deserve credit. The book is pure today, as it was when it left the mouth of the prophet. But I can't follow you, because you have erred from the straight path. I can't follow the white man. I cannot let you be my guide. You have messed up the entire world with your madness. I can't follow you. I cannot follow the Pope of Rome. I cannot follow the Archbishop of Canterbury. Follow the Archbishop of Canterbury.
Please, brother, stop. Please. Please, brother.
I can't follow you. You just lead me around in the same confusion that you are in. When we as Muslims say, "Oh Allah, guide us on the straight path," we said that prayer during the time of the prophet. And three generations after the prophet, he said, we're no longer of him because there's a deviation. The hypocrites have taken over the house of God. So that the house of God has become the house of Satan. Let him in.
Let him in.
Let him in. And if you let him in, there'll be a transformation in your life. You'll be a nigger one day, and then the next day they'll look at you and say, what a man. And God will look at you and say, what a man. This is the man I made. I made him in my image and my likeness, the black man. What a man. Not a boy. What a man. That's you, brothers. That's your potential. I wish I had time, but I don't. Next time I come, I would like to deal with the economics side of this. But wait a minute, brothers. Wait. Don't rush. Look. We're going to have prayer. And then I want us to go out of here like a family. And I don't want you to run out. I want you to stop a minute and look at your brother. Okay? Now, brothers, listen. Just before we have prayer, I want to say this. Next year, we would like to have the largest, most disciplined and serious march on Washington in the history of America. I would like to go to Washington with you. Tell our wives, our girlfriends, our mamas, our daughters, sweethearts, this time you stay at home.
say, sweetheart, you've been so good to us.
So good. Stop, man, stop.
You have been there for us when we weren't there for ourselves. You've gone out in the forefront of the struggle, waiting for us to become real men. But sweetheart, I want you this time to stay home. And I'm going as a representative of our family. And for the first time in our life, we want America to see what real black men look like. We want America and the world to see that God is in the house. Stay on your feet, brother. Stay right on your feet. We want to go to Washington and say to America, on behalf of our families, our fathers worked your fields for nothing for 300 years. And for 100 years since we've been up from slavery, we worked for next to nothing. You took our tax dollars and you used them against us. You fashioned an education that's destructive. You fashioned a social system that makes us outcasts. You've opened a prison system that is the new way to make a slave. Three strikes, and you're in for the rest of your life. You want another plantation, and you want us to work for you for nothing under the guise that we have criminal tendencies. You promised us 40 acres and a mule. And you gave us no 40 acres and a mule, but instead you made us a tool of your wicked aims and aspirations and policies of destruction to the peoples of the world and to our own brothers and sisters. So we come today to present our bodies as a reasonable sacrifice. We come to say to America, we want what is our due. Black man, are you with us? Oh, don't you want to go? Imagine 1 million of us. Not drunk, not high, not coked up, sober, disciplined, with a resolve in our hearts and minds, we come to get justice. I want them to see black men that God is in the house. And they will say, they're serious. They mean business.
That's right.
That's right.
Let's give them what they want. They've come of age now. This is no march to gratify egos. This is no march to pump up some leader. This is serious on behalf of all of our people. On behalf of our women, on behalf of our children. So when you leave here tonight, brothers, and go back out into the streets of Atlanta, when you go, every black brother you see, just stand and look at him. Look at him in his foolishness and say, there is the child of the God. In him is the power of God. And don't talk down to him. Talk up to him. Don't look at him in his drunken state and say he's nothing.
reach down and pick him up. Church, get busy. Mosque, get busy. Temple, get busy. Let's get God in the house. And a new black man will arise. And the same white man that mocked you and scorned you yesterday will tip his hat to you today and say what has happened in his life. And you know what you'll be able to say? Like the man born blind, you say, I met a man named Jesus. And he opened up my eyes. You met a man in whom God was in the house. And he put God in my house. My eyes are open now. My ears are open now. I'm standing up again like a man. And what a man I am. For greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. And now I can do all things through God and his Christ, which strengtheneth me. I don't see anything impossible for me. And there is nothing impossible for you when you let him in the house. Brothers, will you say these words with me? I want you to take this serious pledge. Listen. I say your name. Pledge to strive to love my brother as I love myself. Will you try to do that? I say your name. Pledge that I will never lift my hand or a weapon to do harm to my brother ever again, except in defense of my life. I say your name. Pledge to study to improve myself spiritually, mentally, morally, physically, and economically, for the benefit of myself, my family, and my people. I say your name. Pledge to become a builder of schools, hospitals, housing, business, buy farmland, and enter into international trade and commerce for the good of myself, my family, and my people. Last, I, your name, pledge to give of myself, my time, my talent, my energy, and whatever I can spare of my finance to accomplish what I just said. That pledge. Now, brothers, this isn't about converting nobody, because you don't need to be converted into nothing. You just need to be what God already made you. You're already the righteous. You just need to be yourself. In each area of the city, there will be manhood training classes set up that will go deeper into this training so that we will be more conscious of our duty and responsibility as husbands, fathers, as brothers, and as men. The East location is the Free for All Baptist Church, 2218 Candler Road in Decatur, Georgia. Reverend Stafford, we'll be there with him. That's a strong black brother right there. In the Southwest location, hold it, brothers. We're going to have prayer and then we're going. It will be at the Chapel of Christian Love, 875 Cascade Avenue Southwest in Atlanta, Georgia. In the Northwest location, it will be at the Collier Heights Recreation Center, 3691 Collier Drive. And the central location is the Dunbar Community Center, 477 Windsor Street, Southwest. And of course, Muhammad's Mosque. Where's the address? How could you not put that on this fly? Where is it? 19 Ashby Street, Northwest. Saturday morning at 10 a.m. Be there. We'll meet you there. And we'll go deeper into manhood training.
Go ahead.
Brothers, don't you forget one thing you heard tonight. I know it was deep in some spots,
yes, sir.
But tell the truth. Did you understand it?
Yes.
How many of you understood it? Just raise your hands. How many of you agree with it? Raise your hands.
Yes,
are we brothers?
Yes.
Are we family?
Yes.
All right, after prayer, I want you, soon as prayer is finished, I want you to turn and just shake your brother's hand and embrace your brother. This is the way you do it. Come here, brother. You shake his hand.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Yes, sir.
That ain't no sissy embrace now. If you get a charge out of that, brother, in an unrighteous way, we're going to have to check you out.
Go ahead, bro.
And from now on, when you greet each other, when you see each other, don't say, what up? What up, blood? What up, what down? That ain't no intelligent way. When you greet your brother, you always greet him in peace. If you don't want to say, assalamu alaikum, say peace. And you know what that means? You have nothing to fear from my tongue or from my hands. What you have is sacred to me. What I have is sacred to you. I offer you peace, brother. Will you do that? So when we have prayer, just turn to your brother and just say, peace, brother.
Yeah, yeah.
You don't want to say, assalamu alaikum. It's cool. Because assalamu alaikum is only a prayer that says, peace be unto you. And every Muslim that says that word, he's uttering a prayer to God. And he is reaffirming that from his tongue and from his hands, you will never have to fear him at all.
That's right, brother.
He's your brother, and he wishes you peace. Oh, that's beautiful, isn't it? All right, brothers. With your hands outstretched in this manner, your head slightly bowed,
Please follow me silently in our closing prayer. I will pray a part of it in Arabic and then in English. Kul a'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Maliki Yawm al-Din. Iyaka na'budu wa Iyaka nasta'in. Ihdina siratal mustaqim. Siratal ladina an'amta alayhim. Ghayril maghdubi alayhim. Walladdallin. In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful. Praise be to Allah, the Lord of the worlds, the Beneficent, the Merciful, Master of the Day of Judgment. Thee alone do we worship, thine aid we seek. Guide us on the right path, the path of those upon whom you have bestowed favors, not the path of those upon whom your wrath is brought down, nor of those who go astray. O Allah, we thank you for this meeting, this evening. We praise you for each and every one who attended this meeting. And we ask that the words inspired by you go into the heart of each and every one, that we may know that we have been created by you with a great aim and purpose to be the glory of God and to be perfect reflections of your attributes and characteristics. O Allah, we open our ears and we open our hearts to your word. Come in through your word and stay with us and drive out every false concept and idea that we have held that have made us enemies of yours and enemies of one another. Come in to the house and stay that we may become al-bayt, Allah, the true house of God. And then let us go forth from this place and change the condition under which we live. For you have said that you will never change the condition of a people until there's a change in them. Let that change take place this night, that we may be seen as the servants of God. I bear witness that there is no God but Allah, and I bear witness that Muhammad is your messenger. Amen. Allahu Akbar! Allahu Akbar! Allahu Akbar! Allahu Akbar! That means God is great. Turn to one another, say peace, and embrace your brothers. Thank you, brothers. Assalamu alaikum.
Give it to him, Atlanta. Give him another round of applause.
My name is Thomas Jihad, Fort Lauderdale, Florida, formerly from Hartford, Connecticut. And I am extremely happy to be here. Couldn't have been in a better place. I'm extremely gratified that he came and talked to the men, because black men needs to be talked to. And I bear witness that what he is saying is the truth. And I was fortunate to be there at his inception when he was first introduced to the Honorable Elijah Muhammad 41 years ago. I was there the first time he heard the Honorable Elijah Muhammad I was there the first night he came into the FOI. I was there. He and I were lieutenants together. Mm-hmm. We were assistants to Malcolm X together. Yes, we left New York. I went to Hartford, Connecticut. He went to Boston, Massachusetts. Mm. We worked together for 10 long years and never had a disagreement in 10 long years. So I bear witness that he is the man that should be teaching black people in America today.
My name is with Yahya Adil Rashid. I came in a year after Brother Minister, the Honorable Farja Farrakhan. And we were assistants to Malcolm together, along with Brother Thomas J. and Brother James, Brother Minister Henry, Brother Benjamin, Brother Minister Howell, many brothers, so many that we knew in New York. My tenure has been since 1956, everything that Minister Farrakhan said today was right on time and correct. And every one of our men should have realized that what he was saying for the benefit of them is for the good of our community and for our society and for our nation and people. And I pray Allah that everyone will find the cause and hear the call, that they will come to realize that this is the truth and this is what they need to get what they actually should have within the world that we're living in now. And it will become a world of ours under the leadership and guidance of Almighty God, Allah. And we thank him for everything he has done. And I've been affected by many disabilities, but with all of those disabilities, Allah has allowed me to survive and come to be here today to verify and be a witness. As-salamu alaykum.